Good morning.
Good morning.
I welcome you as we gather to worship in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, our King. I'm Chris. I'm part of the ministry team here at Cross Gates United Methodist Church. It's always a joy to welcome you as we gather to worship any day, but especially this day. What a blessing it is to have you here. You'll find in your bulletin a yellow connection card that I hope each of you will sign and turn in our offering plate. We certainly want those who are visiting with us first time to please give us some information on that, if you will, so that we can contact you and be in touch with you and find out more about you. Also, each of you, I hope you'll do that. Reverend Tom kind of takes seriously that you have signed that in and checks up on us all. So just please be sure you sign that and pass that in the offering plate. It'll be a tremendous help for all of us. Also, just a few announcements. Let me let you know that next Sunday, April the 9th, the United Methodist women are doing a bake sale here in the Fellowship Hall area, and want you to be sure that you come with your money ready to participate in that. Now, let me just tell you, they intentionally are doing this on Palm Sunday to help you out, right? Easter Sunday's right around the corner, and I bet there will be some things that you will just have to have for your family on Easter Sunday. They always do this for missions. This year they're helping out with the Costa Rica mission trip some, as well as they continue to be involved in a lot of things in ministry and mission throughout our state and the world. And so we invite you to participate in that. Also coming up soon, our mission team for Costa Rica is mostly set. There may be one opening on that. There are 12 already committed from here at Cross Gates, another 5 that will join us from Heritage in Hattiesburg. And there's one spot available if anybody feels so led and called to do that. We may could even bump a second or third if we need to. But please let me know as soon as you can. But on April the 23rd, we will be doing a chicken fundraising cooking event. And so we want you to simply help us by having your lunch that day, by offering a donation for the Costa Rica mission trip. Many of our team are families or young folks, youth who are going, older youth who are going. So we will hope for your help and advice in that, and continue to help us in making sure that we're able to make that trip. So you can sign up and pre-register for those meals on your yellow card by just giving us your name, the number of meals, or you can prepay for that as well, and by making sure you designate that on a check for us or give us that good information. But we hope you will join us for that. You'll hear a lot more about that in the weeks to come. I want to just remind our youth that this summer we will once again be going to M28. And the sign up for that starts today. I know many of our youth had prom last night, so they may or may not be among us, but y'all help us pass the word that M28 sign up begins today. We have a limited number of spaces this year, so please sign up as soon as you can to let us know that, and so we can do that. Also, if you would like to donate candy to go in the Easter eggs for our Easter egg hunt on Easter, then please put that in the baskets outside, or let some of our children's ministry team folks know, and they'll be glad to accommodate that. Also, some of you have been collecting the little red banks for Imagine No Malaria. Some of you have just chosen to make a nice donation to that as we participate in the conference's effort to Imagine No Malaria and share in that. You can start bringing those banks in next Sunday or throughout Holy Week, or even on Easter or the Sunday after. But we will collect those together and send that in to the conference so that we can have it there. And so we invite you to join us in that and to bring those in. I shared at the early service this morning, if yours is full of pennies and you would like to turn that in to dollars or some amount, our counters would really love you. But if you only have pennies, that's fine. We'll figure it out somehow and bring that in for us. The next few weeks, we are on a journey in Lent toward Easter. And next week is Holy Week. It begins next Sunday with Palm and Passion Sundays. and we will have incredible worship throughout the week. I've invited Joey to come and share just a little bit about what we can anticipate on Holy Week and starting next Sunday.
Thank you, Chris. Yes, as Chris has shared, next Sunday is Palm Sunday. And it does begin for us the pinnacle of the Lententide journey, Holy Week. In addition to the two services on Palm Sunday, in which there will be special musical elements, that evening will begin our evening worship services throughout the week. Beginning at 6:30 on Sunday evening, we move from Palm to Passiontide, and we look more closely at the journey that Christ takes on that final week, when those shouts of Hosanna that we celebrate on Palm Sunday turn then to mockery and to crucify him. We realize the depth of love that Jesus exemplifies as he continues that path despite the angst and the mockery and the hatred that is turned toward him. On the Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday services, we will be out at the prayer chapel. And these services are contemplative in their structure and are an extended confession, if you will. We've titled them Kyrie, Christe, and Kyrie, which are hints to the Latin tradition of the church, in which inside the spoken liturgy, there is a time for confession in which in Latin we say Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Kyrie eleison, which translates, Lord have mercy, Christ have mercy, Lord have mercy. And in those services of contemplation, we realize that in the story of the Passiontide, we can, if we are honest, recognize ourselves in some of the characters, like Peter, who denies Christ, like the crowd who turns on Christ, and yes, if we are truly honest, even Judas, who betrays Christ. That sets up for us then Maundy Thursday. On Maundy Thursday, we celebrate that on that night before Jesus was crucified, he had a supper with his disciples in an upper room and shared with them a new commandment, a commandment to love as I have loved. We will share in communion, but we will also have an opportunity to follow Jesus to Gethsemane, where he goes to pray just before his arrest, knowing all well what is coming, and the angst in which he is burdened and prays. The scripture says that his prayer became so great that his sweat became as drops of blood. The choir will share as we extend that time of focusing in the garden, the Requiem for the Living. A guest orchestra will join us. Guest soloist will join us. And it'll be an evening in which we, after partaking of communion, will again come to the Kyrie, the asking for forgiveness. And we will realize that through Jesus being our Lamb, our sacrificial Lamb, the Agnus Dei, we can offer our Sanctus, our Holy, 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 because he provides for us through that sacrifice an opportunity to peace and light in a love that has been unmatched and will forever be unmatched. On Friday, we come together at 6:30, focusing upon the seven final words of Christ at the cross. And it is called a tenebrae service. And yes, throughout the service, there will be a darkening of the sanctuary, which represents Jesus's ever inching closer and closer to death. If we don't journey through the pain and the angst of Holy Week, we are shorting ourselves the opportunity to really understand the joy that is Easter, the joy that is Christ's victory over death. So yes, Holy Week leads us to that joy of Easter, which is just 2 weeks away. But journey with us. Journey in the pinnacle of Lententide in these evening worship services beginning next Sunday evening. Thank you.
Such a great season. We invite you to be join us for each service and spend the week journeying with Jesus. Also invite your friends. You caught the importance of Thursday night, and the choir has been preparing diligently for sharing in that requiem with us. So please invite others to join us on that special evening as we share it together. Also, Easter Sunday, we will have two services. One at 6:30 a.m. Our sunrise service will be out at the prayer chapel. And so we anticipate it being there. And then at 10:30, we'll have a worship service in here, and we'll do a lot of fun stuff before and after and between as we share together. So join us for those as we prepare. Well, one thing that I would like for us to do today, and Staff Parish has asked me to be certain that we do this, is to share some important anniversary dates of some of our ministry team. In our church policy and in what we do, there is an opportunity every 5 years for us to celebrate the work and ministry of our team members who are here with us. This year we are celebrating several of those. There's some we're celebrating in this first quarter, and some we will celebrate later in another quarter of anniversary years. Every five-year increment, we also have given a gift to that staff member for their faithfulness. And also, I ask, and the staff parish asks, can we just recognize them here as we worship together? So I just want to take just a moment this morning to share with you some of those, celebrating those anniversary dates this quarter. Like I said, we will be celebrating at least a couple others on down the road. So today, part of our staff, our ministry team, who is celebrating 5 years of service here is Bill Sloop. Bill, would you please stand and maybe even step out to the front for him? Bill is tasked to be our building superintendent, and but most of us know that with any sort of job description in the life of the church, it goes well beyond what we call them. And we are grateful that Bill is celebrating 5 years in the first quarter of this year of service here at Cross Gates United Methodist Church. Vicki Nicholson also is celebrating a 10-year anniversary of being with us. Vicki, are you joining us? What a celebration that is for 10 years of putting up with us and all of the stuff that goes. As I said, office administrator is what we call the job description, but many of you know as well as I that it goes well, well beyond that as well, and we give thanks for her. During this quarter, celebrating 20 years of service is Madera Carr. Madera, would you please just come to the front here? Madera has served as accompanist and pianist for you for those 20 years, and I, again, can just say I know that it's much, much more than that that have been shared with us. We often think that our staff rolls over every year, and I think we forget sometimes that there's been some great continuity and some great persons who have helped us and continue to help us through these years. So a 5-year, a 10-year, and a 20-year anniversary. We give thanks for that. There are more to come in the quarters that come before us, and we will share those as we share together. Will you please once again join me in celebrating this with me? What a joy it is to be able to celebrate. I do want to let you know that Miss Louise Harris passed away. That is Harold Harris's mother, Amanda Harris, and Lauren Pearson's grandmother. And her funeral service will be this afternoon at 3 with visitation from 1:30 until then at Forest United Methodist Church in Forest, Mississippi. So please be in prayer for that family. I communicated by text with Lauren and Paul and with Amanda and with Harold, and all three of them kind of ended in the same scenario. It was such a great experience. They hoped she had made it to heaven in time to witness the Mississippi State women's basketball game. And they all ended their text with the statement, I'm learning to really enjoy and say, praise the Lord and go Dawgs. But what a gift. In 90 years plus, and we celebrate Miss Harris's life, and I invite you to keep them in your prayers this day. Will you join me as we continue our worship as we hear the first reading?
As Jesus was nearing his final days, we find that his teachings become more and more poignant. And in the book of Matthew, we find where there are two instances in which Jesus lays aside any notion that a child is unworthy. He shares these words in Matthew 19. Then little children were being brought to him in order that they might lay his hands, like he might lay his hands on them and pray. The disciples spoke sternly to those who brought them, but Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me, and do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of heaven belongs." And then in chapter 21, addressing the chief scribes and the priests, when they began to see the amazing things he was doing and heard the children crying out in the temple, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they became angry and said to him, "Do you hear what these are saying?" Jesus said to them, "Yes. Have you never read, out of the mouths of infants and babes, you have prepared praise for yourself?" And so today, we hear from the mouths of our children praise. Praise to our Savior, Jesus Christ. Our children, grades 1 through 2, our Melody Maker Choir comes and leads us as we begin our celebration of praise this morning.
Thank you.
Jesus loves, Jesus died, Jesus rose, and Jesus cares. Ask what great thing I know. Let us sing together of Jesus Christ, the crucified. Let us stand as we sing. As we unite our voices, proclaiming together our faith. I believe in God the Creator, who made me in all things, who set me on my path in this world. I believe in God the Savior, who is one with the Creator, who rescued me and all creation from the depredations of our violations against God and creation. This man, Jesus of Nazareth, the Christ, walked a path through this world, taking on human form, having been born of a woman through the power of the Holy Spirit. He lived and worked in this world among people just like me. He walked God's path to death on a cross and rose from the dead to open our pathway to eternal life. I believe in God the Holy Spirit, my counselor and guide, who is one with the Creator and the Christ, who through the body and blood of Jesus brings me into communion with all people, past, present, and future, who calls me to walk a sacred way of life through this world, caring for creation and the people I meet on the way, loving them, helping them, welcoming them without prejudice, being God's hands and feet in the world. Let us remain standing.
Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and seek to live in peace with one another. You may be seated. Let us confess our sin before God and one another. Please join me in the prayer of confession. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Continue our worship with the giving of our tithes and offerings.
Oh,
Will you remain standing for our gospel reading?
This morning's scripture reading comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 11, verses 17 through 27. When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went to meet him, while Mary stayed home. And Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." And Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" And she said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated.
Will you please join me as we pray? God, we give you thanks for your word, for the chance to hear it anew and to have it shape our lives. Lord, for the things that you will reveal to us in it and through it. Lord, I pray you will speak through me and help me to say what you once said. We pray it in the strong name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. We've been on this journey during the season of Lent, a path, if you will, seeking the very heart of God, a path that's been laid before us that leads us into God's presence and reminds us of the importance of taking that journey over and over into the presence of God so that we know the heart of God and are able to live as children of God, restored by His presence with us. We have walked this journey through walking with Jesus Christ. God has made a way for us, a path for us to find His heart. And that comes through belief and trust in Jesus Christ, His only Son, the one who walked this earth. And so we have been journeying with Jesus on the path that was laid before Him as we walk from Lent, begin Ash Wednesday until Easter during this season of Lent. We've walked with Jesus through temptation. We walked with Him as He received a visit at night. We've seen Him share healings and walked with Him to a place of forgiveness. Last week, we walked with Him as He made one who had not had sight since birth be able to see and have sight. And we heard the much deeper call in John's Gospel to know that there were those who were spiritually blind, and that the call for us is, even though we may see with our eyes, to be able to understand who God is and not to have spiritual blindness, but to be able to see how God is at work with us. Our journey continues today to kind of a pinnacle point, a climax, to the place where we hear this story from John chapter 11, and we enter this passage today. As in the last 2 or 3 weeks, it wasn't enough just to hear the selected verses that we've read today. To really grasp the deeper understanding and meaning of this story, we have to look at the whole story laid out for us in John chapter 11 through verse 45 as we share it together. Here it is that we see things unfold even more for Jesus. The story that we have begins in chapter 11, verse 1. I have to just say to you that today, again, I want us to look at the whole story and what the meaning is that we get grasped from this whole story. And in many ways, as we have learned from the Johannine correspondence, from John's Gospel, that we really need to look deeply, because we know that what appears on the surface as a story carries much deeper significance and spiritual meaning. And so we try to delve beneath the surface, but it takes us all 45 verses. I'll just tell you, as a preacher, it's hard not to find one of these points and run down that rabbit trail. Do y'all know what a rabbit trail is for a preacher? Y'all have heard a lot of them, haven't you? You've been witness to preachers going down rabbit trails. As a matter of fact, I'm on one right now. right? That has nothing to do with the sermon, Chris. Move on. There are a lot of rabbit trails I could have gone down. As this gospel unfolds, and we will see in a moment, there are many opportunities to stick with one of the verses, to see what is going on in the beginning, what really was Jesus' relationship with Lazarus and Mary and Martha. They seem to be such good friends that when Lazarus gets sick, they go or expect him to come immediately. So there had to be some relationship there. Why did Jesus wait for 2 days? I mean, he knew Lazarus was dying. Why did he wait? Certainly, he said it's to glorify God, and we could take that rabbit trail for a while. But why did he wait? What about Thomas? It's the first time we're introduced to the disciple named Thomas in any significant way. We'll learn more about him later as we call him Doubting Thomas. But what about Thomas and his statement? It's in the midst of this we learn that Jesus is been to Jerusalem before, and they don't want him back. And Thomas says, well, let's just all go die with him. What about the statement of Jesus to Martha, or from Martha to Jesus, Lord, if you'd been here, my brother wouldn't have died. Or the passage that Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. Jesus wept. Lazarus, come forth. Unbind him and set him free. Any one of those statements are good fodder for a preacher. And all of us give us a sense of this passage, but let's look at the broader story, the bigger picture of what's happening. And hold me accountable not to go down a rabbit trail as we go along the way. And so we see the beginning of the story. John chapter 11, verses 1 through 16 are our setup to this story, to the verses that we shared today to hear who Jesus Christ really is. In those verses, we find out that Jesus is away from Jerusalem, away from Bethany, but that Mary and Martha and their brother Lazarus live in a community called Bethany, a village very near Jerusalem, which is significant. And they call to Jesus, Mary and Martha do. And Mary and Martha have this relationship. It's here in these verses that we find out that Mary is the one who had anointed Jesus' feet with oil on a prayer occasion and had wiped them with her hair. So there must have been some sort of intimate relationship with Mary, Martha, Lazarus, and Jesus. That there had to be some strong connection. A connection strong enough that they would send word to Jesus, as busy as he was. And they knew that. That his brother, their brother, was sick. Very sick. Jesus says to them, it leads to glorify God. And we catch our first glimpses in John's gospel that this story is going to go deeper than simply Jesus' relationship with Lazarus and Mary and Martha, or even being raised from the dead. But there's the glorifying God that comes in the midst of it. So Jesus does stay put for 2 days, uncharacteristic. He holds back. He waits. And certainly by the time that he waited, Lazarus was dead. It's here that we see that Jesus has a death threat put out on him. There had been an experience in Jerusalem where the religious officials had told him and his disciples, you better leave now, and if we ever see you back here again, we're going to kill you. Obviously, the disciples had heard that. Obviously, they had heard from their relatives or from somebody that they did not need to come back to the area of Jerusalem or the surrounding area because they were waiting to have Jesus killed. It's in the midst of this story, the end of the verses, verse 16, that as Jesus says to them, Lazarus is asleep, and the disciples say, good deal, if he's asleep, he'll wake up. No problem, right? We can just stay here or move on out into the Galilee area or go to the desert even where John was and find ourselves there. But Jesus says, no, we're going back to Judea. We're going back to Jerusalem. We're going back to Bethany. Come on, let's go. And Thomas, in a very sarcastic way, says, well, great. Let's just all go and die with him, right? Did you hear it? If you've ever wondered if there's sarcasm in the Bible, look right there at Thomas. Let's just all go die with him, knowing what he faced. We enter then into verses 17 through 27, the verses Taylor read for us today, and we see at the very onset, Lazarus has been dead for 4 days. The people had already gathered, bringing casseroles, and they had already brought the fried chicken to the family, and they were hanging around, helping them grieve the loss of their brother. And so the people came from as far as Jerusalem again, the very place that they weren't supposed to be near, and they were there with the family. As Jesus approaches their home, Martha hears that Jesus is on his way, and she runs out to meet him. And where she meets him there, she falls down at his feet and says to him, Lord, if you'd have been here, my brother would not have died. We've spent a little bit of time in our staff meeting around this particular passage, and we wondered if this was Martha just simply acknowledging that Jesus could have done something about the situation, but now she was glad he was here to be with them during this time, or if it was more pointed than that, something like, Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. Well, it's up to you to determine that. I will suggest to you, if Martha didn't say it that way, maybe later her sister Mary did. And they felt like he had somewhat deserted them. How many times have you, in the moments of your life and what we perceive to be crisis, say, Lord, if you had just been here. As a pastor, I get to hear it quite often. People struggling with where God's at. And why didn't God intervene in my situation? And so we began here to realize that Jesus begins to prompt her by saying, Martha, I am the resurrection and life. Your brother will come to life. He will be raised. And Martha says, I know he will come to life in the great day of resurrection. And Jesus says, Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. It's here that we began to understand that John is pushing us to a much deeper level. It's here that we began to understand that Jesus himself is about to walk this journey of life. That Jesus himself will face his own death. And yet he affirms that he is the resurrection and the life. Verses 28 through 37 of John chapter 11 gives us the scene kind of replayed. Martha goes and tells her sister Mary that the Lord is here and wants to see her. And Mary runs out and falls at Jesus' feet, probably the posture she had when she anointed him before. And Mary said to him, Lord, if you'd been here, my brother wouldn't have died. And Jesus says with her, your brother will live. This is to glorify God. And in this scene, we see the people weeping. And we see the Jesus who is fully human, bearing the hurts of his friends. And whether he wept because he was so heartfelt, desire to help with Mary and Martha and Lazarus, or whether he wept because people weren't quite catching who he was. We know that Jesus entered their pain and that Jesus wept. I've learned as a pastor that sometimes when we enter into situations where people struggle and have sorrow and even death, that there's sometimes that I really don't have the answers. And better than trying to make up an answer or say words that are simply words, I've learned that sometimes it's okay to simply be with people and weep. And Jesus wept. Jesus was fully present with this family, offering his love, offering the grace of God, offering his presence. And so they went to the tomb. And in verses 38 through 45, the story really unfolds as Jesus goes to the tomb and asks the stone to be rolled away. And he realizes, as Martha says, Lord, he's been dead 4 days now. It's not going to be pretty, right? And yet Jesus continues to pray to God. And he lifts up his prayers and says, Lord, we come to this place to glorify you. May your presence be known here and your power be felt here. Lord, here is this grave, this cave with a dead man in it. Only you have the power to bring life. And then Jesus says, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus gets up and walks out as best he could, wrapped in linen cloth, where they had prepared him with spices because he was dead and buried. And as Lazarus comes forth, Jesus says to those, unbind him and set him free. And we grasp that it's not just about a resurrection story for his friend Lazarus. That Jesus himself will walk this path. And yet in God's power and God's presence, we realize that before his own death and resurrection, Jesus proclaims the power of God over death as he resurrects his friend Lazarus. No longer does the tomb have a stronghold. No longer does death have a grip, because Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life. Knowing full well he will face his own death, God shows forth his power in Jesus over death before he gets there. Jesus Christ has conquered the grave. For those who believe in Jesus Christ, death is not the final answer, but life is, and resurrection is, and hope is. Jesus has the power. So that when we celebrate Easter, we understand that resurrection was not a one-time event, but that Jesus Christ has the power to bring resurrection to us and to give us life. I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Christ comes to give us life. Life eternal, but life fully now. Do you trust in the one who comes to offer us life? Will you walk the path that conquers death and the grave and brings us life and victory? Many of you have had the opportunity to read the newsletter for this past month, and hopefully you took just a minute to read the article that I shared. But I shared in there the opportunities I've had over this Lenten season to participate in the services of death and resurrection, to stand with people in their grief and yet be hope and see hope, to be with them in the time of death, and to hear those words again, where, O death, is your victory? Where, O grave, is your sting? Where, O God? But thanks be to God through Jesus Christ, we have the victory for life and for life eternal. Jesus Christ is the path to eternal life. Will you know the victory? Will you walk the path? Sheila tells me all the time that when I turn on my Pandora, yes, I'm still old school for you younger folks, and that's a wonderful place you can listen to music that you want to, older folks. Pandora, you can select, and one of my selections is Doyle Lawson and Quicksilver, that radio station. But Sheila, after about the third song, says every time to me, all they sing about is heaven. And I say to her, no, all they really are singing about is victory. And that hope we have. One of my favorite songs, number 370 in the hymnal. See, I even remember the number. But before that, it came from the Cokesbury, or the little spiritual life book. But it goes something like this. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory. And I heard about those streets of gold beyond the crystal sea. About the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Join me. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Victory comes in following Jesus Christ. May we know His power, His presence, His resurrecting gift and life. Amen. Will you join me as we join together in the great Thanksgiving? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, who looked for the day when justice shall roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. As we go to share together in a time of prayer, and as we come to this altar, we lift up these concerns and joys that have been shared with us. We pray for Jeff Caldwell, for Mary Ann Mallory, for Louise Harris family, for Carol Harrison, for Donna Thomas, for John Armstrong, for J.B. McDonald, for Brian Panair, for Elizabeth Helms. And today we share in joy and give thanks for the beautiful spring weather that we're having. And now let us join our hearts and voices together as we pray the prayer Jesus taught us as we say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. I'd like to invite those who are going to assist today to please join me here at the altar. things are ready and you're invited to come to Christ's table. The ushers will kind of give some direction as to how to come as per section. You don't have to be a member of this church or the United Methodist Church, because we believe it's an open communion and that God offers you this invitation. So please come and partake. Spend time at this altar and know that God's presence is with you. Will you come? Thank you. join me as we pray together the prayer after communion? Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we would go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others.
In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Our closing hymn is printed in our bulletin. Lord, if only. Let us stand as we sing.
Christ who brings you victory, walk with you this week. May you know his presence. Know that the Christ who offered resurrection and life to Lazarus himself walked a journey to a cross so that he could bring you and I with him and offer us life. Go forth to follow and to be his people. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.